Welcome. This is Accounting with Bennett Tchaikovsky. Our topic today is going to be non-current liabilities, bonds, essentially the general terminology. Copyright 2008 to 2018 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. I do ask that if you link or forward to this presentation, please give proper attribution. So when we're talking about these next chapters in terms of we're progressing down the balance sheet and we're looking at liabilities and equity. And what we're really saying is of our balance sheet equation or assets equals liabilities plus owner's equity, the liabilities and the owner's equity are really talking about how are those assets owned. And oftentimes it gets into a discussion of what we call corporate finance. So how do we raise, and it's what we're talking about with corporate finance is how are we going to be raising money to operate? And the one challenge is if we are selling stock is we may be diluted. And what does that mean? Well, if I own 100% of something, and then I start selling shares, which represents 50% of my company, I've thereby diluted myself. And that's something what a lot of owners really struggle with, is that, do I want to give up ownership? Should I be giving ownership? What do I really do here? The offshoot of that is like, if I do sell stock, I don't really have to, I'm not compelled to pay a dividend. I don't have to pay the money back. But on the flip side of that, if we look at bonds and or other called long-term debt, we don't have any dilution. What does that mean? We're not giving up any type of ownership control. One of the things that Amazon did when they first started up is they did do an offering. However, at the same time, they really used long-term debt to finance most of their expansion. And if you look at Amazon, interestingly enough, they really haven't gone out and done a lot of stock issuances essentially after their first initial round. But going back to and they don't need to because they are so strong that they can just borrow money and then borrow more money. So when we look at bonds and we look at this other long-term debt, instead of issuing stock, which we don't have to repay back, if we are issuing bonds or other long-term debt, it could be a loan, if we're raising money through that loan, I have to pay it back. And when I am a company, I'm going to have to be paying that back with interest. So that's kind of the general form of the debt that we're going to be discussing today. And as far as how this works is that can every single type of company use bonds to raise money? And the answer to that is not really. You have to be an established company, more than likely publicly traded, or you have to have incredibly good credit with your bank to borrow money as a business or have assets which you can turn around and essentially pledge or secure. And so, or if your corporate credit is good enough, then you don't need anything. But what generally happens is, and let's talk a little bit about bonds first, is that, so I'm a company, I don't want to issue shares because I don't want to become diluted. So what I'm going to go through and do is I'm essentially going to raise money by selling bonds. And down here, if we look at the recent issuance here of Microsoft, Microsoft not long ago went through and did some issuances. And I've kind of put this over here on the Google Sheet. But if you look up Microsoft Corporation's SEC filing, from January 30th, 2017, you'll see here kind of a going through here and looking at these different notes, and then they have some other securities listed out here, and this is probably the closest, most recent example that I could really find for you when it comes to bonds. And here's another one. And so here are different notes that are going to be due. And this note essentially can also function like a bond. Sure. It's just going to be a long-term note, and it's going to have the same type of valuation issues that we were going to kind of see here with the bonds. So going back up here is, so we're in corporate finance. We're trying to raise money from our for our company. Generally, the way that most bonds or notes work is that they're essentially like an interest-only loan. What does that mean? Well, when our parents take out a mortgage, or when our friends take out a mortgage on a house, when that happens, if it is the primary mortgage, every time they're making a payment, part of it's going to principal and the remaining part is going to interest. With bonds, most of these are working like an interest-only loan. We are paying an amount of interest every single year. And then upon maturity of that bond, we have to repay back the principal or whatever that face amount is of that bond that we originally issued to our investors. So again, when you're thinking about bonds, think about it like an interest-only loan. When it comes to the bond indenture, what is an indenture, or what is, I should say, a bond indenture? What a bond indenture is this is a contract between the bond issuer and the bond holder. It's really going to go through and describe the rights and obligations of each party. And as far as the terms of the bond, really, this is going to be something that will be dictated by the company's representatives, which are generally going to be the investment bank, and perhaps the lead investor, or that one investor who is kind of speaking on behalf of all others for the offering. So another really important bond part here is what we call the stated value, which is going to be the amount, or face value, the amount is going to be paid upon maturity. So when this bond matures, it's going to essentially be paying off that stated or that face value. Again, this is what the bond will be paying upon the bond's maturity or when it becomes due. The par value will oftentimes refer to the denomination that the bonds are issued in. Now, if I'm a company and I want to have a lot of people be able to invest in my bonds, I might be using increments of $100 per bond, or maybe even $1,000 per bond. And that's really referring to the par value of that one particular bond. So again, you just have to kind of look at the different terminology. If I were to say, well, I issued 1,000 bonds that had a $1,000 par value, then what would that be worth? Well, 1,000 bonds. And then I had a 1,000 par value per bond. The total basically stated or face value of these bonds, or the amount that's going to be subject to have to be repaid, is going to be $1 million. So again, that's something here that we're just kind of, again, it's another way of coming up with that stated value or that face value of that bond. What is a secured bond? Well, it's going to be a bond that's being issued by the company, but it is going to be secured by assets. And what this is really for is that if the issuer is defaulting, the bondholder can go after the issuer assets directly that are secured by the bond. And just to kind of an example, if there was, say, a large company that, say, had a lot of real estate holdings and they did a bond issuance, but say their business really wasn't going that well, the bondholders might say, well, or the investors might say, look, we're willing to loan you this money to fund your operations. However, we want these bonds to be secured by your real estate assets. So again, this is, again, something that's going to be negotiated. An unsecured bond is a bond that is not secured by the issuer's assets. It's really secured by the issuer's name. It's essentially up to that issuer to go through and repay the bond. As a company, if you don't repay your bonds and if you don't pay your obligations, is it going to be difficult for you to raise money in the future? And the answer is yes. There are different bond rating agencies that will say, oh, this bond, this company is not good. This company is good. And that's really going to be impacting the interest rates that these bonds will have to go through and pay. So a stated rate of interest, the stated rate of interest is a very important interest rate. It is the rate that is going to be stated on the bond contract or that indenture. And this is going to be the cash paid by the issuer for the interest. And this is what we call the stated rate of interest. When you're looking at the rate of interest that a bond is paying, always assume that this is going to be an annual rate of interest. Even if the bond is paying interest in different ways, quarterly, semi-annual, or annual, when you see an interest rate on that bond, always assume it's going to be an annual rate of interest. And we'll talk about that a little bit later on. What is the market rate of interest? Well, the market rate of interest is that interest rate that was out there upon the issuance of the bonds. Now, the stated rate of interest and market rate of interest can sometimes be the same, but oftentimes they're going to be different. And this is what we're going to be talking about a little bit later on when we look at the actual bond issuance, is what is that difference between that stated rate and the market rate of interest. Another little side note is that when we have here a stated rate of interest that is very, very high, if you're looking for some extra reading or some extra things to do, you can take a look at Michael Milken, who invented junk bonds back in the day. Those are not bonds to finance heroin transactions. Rather, these were bonds for very, very risky investments. There is a great film that is on available right now on Netflix or on Hulu. Actually, I think it's on Netflix. It's called Electric Boogaloo, The Wild Untold Story of Canon Films. Great documentary. In that, they talk about how Canon got its financing and they borrowed essentially from Milken. And these were essentially junk bonds because the interest rate they were paying was very, very high compared to the regular market rate of interest. Okay, what does quarterly, semi-annual, or annual mean? This refers to how often is interest being paid by the company. Quarterly means every 3 months, semi-annual means every 6 months, annual means once per year. And this becomes important because when we see, say, a stated rate of 8%, that's always going to be an annual rate. And with that annual rate, if we're saying paying semi-annually, then or twice a year, then we're going to have to multiply that rate by a half or by 50% to determine the interest rate for that appropriate period. So term bonds, basically what a term bond is a bond that matures on a single date, but it will pay an interest rate, or basically it will pay interest over time. There's also something called a zero coupon bond. And this is a bond that does not pay interest. Rather, what's going to happen here is that the whole lump sum is going to be paid upon maturity, but no interest is paid every year. And over here, we've got callable bonds. What is a callable bond? What that means is that a company can essentially repurchase those bonds from an investor prior to the maturity date. So for example, if I'm a company that is issued, say, 15% bonds, and I have a callable right, or I have the bonds are callable, and say if the market rate drops down to 5%, then what I want to do is maybe refinance or call back those bonds, pay those bonds off, and then, you know, essentially get money cheaper. However, note, this is all going to be negotiated. All these terms here, as far as, you know, how strong is this company? How can the company go through and negotiate this? What is a convertible bond? This is a bond that can be converted into equity. And this really gives investors the best of both worlds. Well, you owe me money on the form of a bond, But if your stock gets hot or if things are looking really good, then I can convert my bonds into equity. And so again, are all bonds convertible? No, it's going to depend on what's being negotiated. So a discount on bonds payable is going to be happening when the stated rate of interest is lower than the market rate of interest. Again, the stated rate of interest is going to be lower than the market rate of interest. So let's give an example of this. So when we're looking here at the stated rate, say here it is 8%, and the market rate is going to be 10%. And what's going to happen here, and we're going to see this in a later lesson, but what's going to happen here is that if my bond has a stated rate of 8%, but the market rate is 10%, will anybody want my bond? And the answer is no. No one wants my bond because they can go out and get better interest return elsewhere. So what's going to happen is that my bond, my 8% bond, is going to be discounted. And that bond is going to be discounted to reflect the market rate of interest. So when the stated rate is below the market rate of interest, the bond is going to be discounted. And we're going to go into this a little bit later. What about a premium on bonds payable? Well, this is going to happen in the opposite. And where this is going to really be here is this, if we have a stated rate, say of 10%, and then we have a market rate of say 7%, what's going to happen here? The bond will sell at a premium or above face value, And the reason why it's going to sell at a premium is because everybody wants my bond. If my bond has a 10% stated rate, but the market rate is at 7%, will people want it? Absolutely, yes. So that's what is happening when we have what we call a premium on bonds payable. And over here, the carrying value, what exactly is that? Well, when we get to the discount and premium, what the carrying value refers to is that bond payable, which will always be shown at the face value or the stated value plus any premium or minus any discount, that bonds payable net or bonds payable at carrying value will essentially be, that's essentially what will be carried, that's what my company's books will show as the value of that bond. So it's going to be a bond payable minus any discounts or a bond payable plus any premiums. That's going to give my carrying value. So for the segment we're going about to look at, the really important parts here is essentially that stated value or the amount that will be paid upon the bond's maturity or when it's due. Stated rate of interest, what is the stated rate on that bond indenture? What is that bond going to be paying? The market rate of interest. The market rate of interest, again, is this is the market rate when that bond is being issued. I don't care if the market rate changes after the date of the bond issuance. What I'm doing is I'm essentially recording it on that day using the market rate of interest. And lastly, we'll be having annual or semi-annual interest payments. And those are really the important parts of looking at going into this next segment. So thank you very much for your time today. And I look forward to seeing you on the next episode of Bonds Payable. Thank you.